warning. This experiment uses toxic chlorine gas. This experiment must be performed outside in a fume hood. Greetings, fellow nerds. In this video, we're going to make potassium permanganate. It's a useful oxidant, and owing to its strong color, it has special application in redox titrations, as we demonstrate when measuring the concentration of hydrogen peroxide. For many amateurs, it's not difficult to obtain, and I personally buy it as greensand filter regenerant. So making it is not cheaper than buying it. It's more one of those trophy achievements for the amateur chemist because of its nice purple color, and it's quite rewarding to produce something so beautiful. As usual, our primary objective is to explore the science. So let's get started. We first weigh out 43 grams of manganese dioxide. It's available as filter media for greensand filters, and I'm using pottery-grade manganese dioxide, which admittedly is not very good, but it works. My particular brand claims it's 75% pure, with the rest being sand and iron oxide. I didn't use manganese dioxide from batteries as it's mixed with carbon and would burn with our next chemical, 25 grams of potassium chlorate. Other amateurs have said you can still use battery-sourced manganese dioxide mixed with carbon if you use more potassium chlorate to compensate, but I haven't had time to fully test that. Anyway, thoroughly mix the two compounds. Now we get an iron can, and that will be our crucible for the reaction. We can't use glass, as glass will dissolve in the potassium hydroxide. To the can, we add 40 milliliters of water, and then we dissolve in 60 grams of potassium hydroxide. The water is optional, and I only add it so that the potassium hydroxide would be evenly distributed and wouldn't clump up. But many amateurs don't bother, and they still get very high yields. We then mix in the manganese dioxide and potassium chlorate from earlier, and thoroughly stir to mix up the reagents. Now place the can in a furnace, and we heat to 400 Celsius for several hours. You don't need an oven furnace though, and heating for 10 minutes with a propane torch until it's red hot seems to work. Other amateurs have simply heated the can on a gas or electric stove with good yield as well. So what's happening is the potassium chlorate is oxidizing the manganese dioxide to potassium manganate. The potassium hydroxide provides the potassium ions and alkaline conditions necessary to stabilize the higher oxidation state of manganese. Without the potassium hydroxide, the manganese dioxide would just catalytically decompose the potassium chlorate to release oxygen, and that actually serves as the basis for creating oxygen in some experiments. But for us, we need that potassium hydroxide to make potassium manganate. So could we add even more potassium chlorate and oxidize further all the way to potassium permanganate? Unfortunately, only potassium manganate is stable under these conditions, and we can't go all the way to permanganate yet. Although it would be tremendously convenient if we could. Now the question always comes up if we can use sodium hydroxide in chlorates and make sodium permanganate this way. Unfortunately, the sodium manganate necessary to make it is not stable under these conditions, and so yields would be extremely low. So for now, we'll focus on making potassium permanganate. Anyway, after heating, I let it cool and took it out. The extremely corrosive mixture actually ate a small hole in the can and leaked out a little bit. So we'll have to keep it in a beaker to contain everything. About 300 milliliters of water is added and allowed to soak in for a few hours. This is to let it permeate into the mixture of potassium manganate and potassium chloride and make it easier to break up. After an hour, the liquid is poured out and saved. We still need the solid chunks of potassium manganate in the bottom of the can, so get a hammer and chisel and actually chisel it out. The soaking should make it easier, but it's still a rock. Get everything out and add it to our mixture. Stir it for an hour or two to break up the chunks and turn it into a thick slurry. It won't dissolve, but there shouldn't be any solid chunks. So now we have our mixture of potassium manganate, potassium hydroxide, and unreacted manganese dioxide and potassium chlorate. We'll need to oxidize it one electron further to make potassium permanganate. We transfer it to a larger flask and use a little bit of water to wash it over. You can already see it turning purple as the water dilutes the potassium manganate enough that disproportionates into manganese dioxide and potassium permanganate. The amount is very small, but the color is very strong. But we want something higher yielding. The fastest and highest yielding method is to use chlorine gas. I have here a chlorine generator consisting of 45 grams of trichloroisocyanuric acid in about 100 milliliters of water, and up here is 75 milliliters of hydrochloric acid. The acid is dripped into the trichloroisocyanuric acid and generates chlorine gas, which is fed into the flask of potassium manganate. We don't need to stick the gas tube directly into the solution and risk backflow. The chlorine gas is very soluble in the strongly alkaline mixture and reacts very quickly. What's happening is the chlorine is oxidizing the potassium manganate to potassium permanganate with a byproduct of potassium chloride. Industrially, electrolysis is used to directly oxidize and precipitate the potassium permanganate. I might try electrolytic processes in the future, but for now I want to brute force it with chlorine gas. If you don't want to use chlorine gas, then a much safer alternative is carbon dioxide. You use the exact same setup, but instead of trichloroisocyanuric acid, you use sodium carbonate or bicarbonate and feed the carbon dioxide into the potassium manganate. The carbon dioxide doesn't react directly with it, but instead lowers the pH enough that the potassium manganate is no longer stable and disproportionates into potassium permanganate and manganese dioxide. The drawback is that the yield is reduced by 1/3 since that's spent to oxidize the other 2/3. But since carbon dioxide is relatively safe and less toxic compared to chlorine, you don't need a fume hood and can even perform the reaction indoors if you desire. Anyway, once all the acid is added and the gas injected, let it stir for another hour to completely react. Then place the mixture in an ice bath or even a freezer and chill it for a few hours until the temperature equalizes. The potassium permanganate is less soluble than the potassium chloride and hypochlorite at cold temperatures, so this allows us to purify it. Once the flask is cooled, we vacuum filter the mixture and retain the residue. Now boil 300 milliliters of water, and in three portions we dissolve and suction filter the residue while it's still on the filter frit. Potassium permanganate is much more soluble in hot water, and we leave behind the insoluble unreacted manganese dioxide, as well as any fillers like sand. I find dissolving and filtering in three portions slightly better than mixing all the hot water at once, as more of the permanganate washes out. And here is the solution of purified potassium permanganate. We then chill the solution in an ice bath and crystallize out the potassium permanganate. Then we suction filter again to recover the crystals. And that is beautiful. Potassium permanganate crystals are black needles, and that alone makes them quite a sight compared to all the white powders we chemists usually deal with. Anyway, I'm going to continue drawing a vacuum for an hour to thoroughly dry them before transferring them to a beaker and taking the mass. While that's going, remember the 300 milliliters of filtrate? We can recover additional potassium permanganate by boiling it down from 300 milliliters down to 100 milliliters, and again chilling on ice before suction filtering one more time. So the final yield is 25 grams for the first crystallization and 5.7 grams for the second. Total yield of around 30.7 grams or 39%. But since the manganese dioxide I used was pottery grade and was assayed to be 75% pure, our adjusted yield would be 52% if we're going by the assayed amount. Now the yield is great, but what about purity? Fortunately, we now have the methodology to determine this using titration. So I performed a titration on the two crystallizations of potassium permanganate and found them both to be 99% pure to an error of 1%. For more information on how I did this, look at my previous video on titrating hydrogen peroxide. Anyway, 52% adjusted yield at 99% purity to 1% error is pretty good. I could evaporate the final residue to get a bit more, but since my objective was purity, I didn't bother for just another couple of grams. But an alternative recovery method to get even higher yield is to not chill the mixture after chlorine injection, but instead do the opposite and boil it directly and dissolve everything and filter while hot. Then chill the filtrate to crystallize it, and filter once again to collect the crystals. Because we're not redissolving the potassium permanganate in water a second time, we get more recovery. The cost, however, is slightly reduced purity, but for most amateurs that's a non-issue, and if you're not after the highest analytical grade purity like I was, then that might be the better recovery method. It's still going to be better than 90% pure. But with results like this, I think we're still doing great. So I'm not going to embark on a yield optimization project like with sodium. Okay, so a couple of notes before I go. The residue of unreacted manganese dioxide, as well as sand and other filters from the first filtration, can be saved and fed forward as a source of manganese dioxide in the next run. But it's severely depleted in manganese dioxide, so it might not be worth it if you already have plentiful supplies of it. The second note I want to make is the potassium permanganate itself is very slightly light sensitive. For amateur purposes, this is not an issue, but for long-term storage, store it in an opaque container or transfer it to an amber glass bottle. Properly stored, it can last for decades. So that's how you make and purify potassium permanganate. The trick is to use potassium chlorate as the oxidant. Thanks for watching. I hope that video was useful. In the future, I might try electrolytic processes to make potassium permanganate that don't require high temperatures. Check in with me again in another 10 years. Special thank you to all of my supporters on Patreon for making these science videos possible with their donations and their direction. If you're not currently a patron but would like to support the continued production of science videos like this one, then check out my Patreon page here or in the video description. I really appreciate any and all support.